Hi guys, welcome back. My name is Paul Kroon and I'm a Power Platform Specialist at Macau in the Netherlands. And this is the second video in a series of two videos about getting a lock inside of SharePoint based on all the changes your users make. And in the last video, we created the logic in SharePoint and we created our formulas to store our data. And in this video, we will get that data from our record and then just apply this logic into a table. Let's show you what I mean. So the last time I already showed you this solution. So here we have our record, and if we apply another status and save this record, you will see on the right there is an extra line in our table, an extra line in our CSV which we created in the last video. And then when we click this button, we see here a table of our data. And this part is what we're going to build from scratch, step by step, because we need some formulas for data manipulation, because we use the CSV and we have to loop through the CSV and create some HTML elements. Now, you think HTML, it's going to be difficult, but again, we're going to take this step by step, and believe me, it's very easy. And you can just Google some things and just incorporate them. Basically easy, trust me. So this approach I use until there is a parse JSON from text file. As I said in the earlier video, it's not there. So we can store a JSON string somewhere based on the collection, but we can have a JSON string inside of Power Apps and then convert that to a collection. That would be a real change in this kind of logic and make it a lot easier. So again, in the comments, I will add a link. And if you like it as much as me, that Power Apps would enable this, it's still on the review, but a lot of votes will help us get there. So please vote, I would say. Okay, no further ado, let's go to our application and let's start building this lock file. So let's go to the container in which my form is, because I have a top container here, and in there I want to have something pop up which shows me the lock and then go down when I click again. So I already have an icon here which is basically updating a variable, just a toggle, just a boolean set to true when it's false and false when it's true. So a toggle. And then this is also connected to the X parameter to make it the whole page. So when I click this, let's click this so you can see what happens. Now we see all the icons, and when we click it, it's on top of all the icons. So we can only click this lock kind of thing wherever we click. And then when we are in this phase, we should have something on top of this form showing us all the changes we make from creation till the status we are in now. And of course, show us the people who make those changes based on this CSV. Gonna be fun. Let's do it. So first, when we look at this, we go to the top container. And normally I would say maybe it would be a nice thing to use a data table or a gallery. But the problem in a gallery is that it doesn't have headers, so I have to build all the headers from scratch and then apply the logic. And I have a lot of things loaded into my application, which I basically not need a lot. So, and it's static data, so we don't have to perform actions on this. So, okay, that's not the way to go. The problem for the data table, which I would normally use because it's out of the box available, the problem there is that we can't put it on a container yet. They forget to add it to the possible childs of a container. So as long as they don't have those things, when we add it, it's always going to the screen itself. It's never going to our container. And then the structure of my app is gonna be trashed. I'm gonna have a hard time managing my app. So that's why I never use a data table. And sometimes I would like to have a data table when I want to have set up an Excel-like list very fast. I don't particularly like the design, but functional, it's okay by me. But still, no containers, so no way. So we had to use another approach here. So what I thought of, okay, maybe we can just create some HTML and create a table from there. And the upside about that is that it's gonna load a lot faster, because a lot of things we have with containers and with galleries and whatever, we don't have using an HTML text. It's very lightweighted, so very nice. So let's put that on the screen, no further ado, and say put it in X, and I normally just say make it a formula, because else when you copy it, it's gonna be 40 again, and I don't like it, and a formula just states 0. 0 plus 0 is 0, it's just a formula, just a trick. Then it should be right under the navigation element, which is in a container, which I called process form navigation container dot height. So it's under my navigation. Then the width should be relative to the parent, because it should scale when my device becomes bigger or smaller. And the same for the height, it should be the same as the parent, only then it's longer under the parent. So I want to have the Y parameter of itself, which is just a number taking off, and then it basically scales from under our container till the whole button. Okay, so now we have scaled this. Let's make this a white so we can see it. And then the visible property should be connected to this variable I toggle to show this or not. So now when I toggle it, it's gonna go away. Toggle again, it's gonna be visible. And here I want to show this table like thing we created here. And now maybe you say, okay, it's gonna be HTML, it's gonna be very complicated, but trust me, it's not. It's very, 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 very easy. But let's do it. Now, first, when you don't know HTML, you just say HTML table, and the best thing to pick then is always three schools for a starter. And the first is the table. We click this, and just the first table we find. Let's copy this, go to Power Apps, and put it in our text HTML text. Now, we get an error here, but that's from the double quotes, and make it single quotes, and then the error is away. And if we look, hey, we have a table. How nice is that? Of course, we want to style the table a little bit. Let's say the text should be on the left. We want to make it purple with white letters to have a nice header. And of course, we don't want padding, because we want to have it attached to the surfaces everywhere, because this is just showing something. So let's go here. And what we want to do is to say, okay, let's apply some style. And the style is single quotes again, because we want to have the style with some text. And this is CSS. So we can have CSS background color. Background color. I see my camera stopped, so let's change this to the integrated webcam. Okay, now you see me again. It's a little bit less nice, but it will work for now. So we can go on. And let's switch to the whole screen, because you don't have to see my face really, I would say. So let's go here and put this here. So let's go on. So we can have CSS background color, and just Google that, and then you have CSS 3W schools again, and you see the background color could be coral. Just copy this part, go to Power Apps, and say, okay, the background color should be coral. And then we have coral. It's as easy as this. Doesn't become very much more complicated here, but don't let it make coral. And let's, can see my whole screen, so let's make this purple. Then maybe we want to have a text align of left. We close this and then say the color should be white. And if we then run it, you see it's on the left, it's white and it's purple. Nice. Now I don't like it directly to the surface, so let's apply some padding. Let's try it here. Padding. Let's say 8 pixels. Close. But now I think it doesn't work here. So we can put this on the container containing all the headers. So let's take it from here and try to do exactly the same here with the text string again. And the padding to 8. And you see now we have the padding 8 on the top, on the bottom, the left and the right. So if we only want to apply it to the left, we only have to do apply it only to the left. Then copy this part and paste it for every table. And then our tables are nicely organized and nicely styled. So I think. So that's the first step. Then we say, okay, let's make this a text and do an end parameter and make another part text, close this text, do end and this text, because this is the part which should be dynamic based on our input of our record. But don't, let's not apply our formulas here. Let's go to our dashboard, just put in a label, just for now, to be able to build our solution here. Let's make it white, and instead of the text, let's say we have a processing selected dots is log available. And here you see this is our text. But of course, we don't want this text. We first want the headers off, then we want to separate all these values, put it in a collection, then run to it and return our values in our rows of our table. Now, let's do it step by step. The first thing we have to do is to say, let's split this text. And let's split it based on the char, which we also use to concatenate. Now, we get an error because here we like to have text and this is an array. So let's separate this table we have now. And if we look here, we have a table. And I'll just say the results, we want to concatenate into a text. So now we first split it to a table and then we paste it. And you see the line feeds are away on this moment, but still the text is the same as we had. So that's the first step. Now, then we want to separate the first line. So the first line should go out. So let's say this is our data. Let's relabel this and then or let's say this is the result. Oh no, don't do this. Let's first create a scope here. So we can create a scope with a width formula, as I stated before in the previous video, and then close this width formula here. And still the result is the same because we return this array from the width formula, which is handed over to the concat formula. But here we want to do something because we need to take the first line off. And how can we do this? So let's pick this part, copy this, and say in this scope, I want to have our data in. And I want to have this data in, the table put in this data in. And here I have all my lines. So what I can do now is go here and say we want to take off the first item. So let's use the last formula with our data in and then count the rows of our table here and then take one off. And then we have the last without the first. And if we now look, the header part is gone. So the first goal we have achieved already. Now with this, we like to loop through those items and create for every item, for every row, create a little bit of HTML. So the formula to loop through those items is the for all formula. So let's use that and then return the things we have here, which is normally the results or this record. But this record is not very nice to use. So let's say, let's give it an alias and say you are called lines. So this part, this table is now called lines and we can return those lines. And again, we have our text here. Now for every line, this is basically a comma separated string, right? So basically we can split this again on the commas. So let's do that. And then loop through those items. So we split it, get an array, then we create a piece of text based on our elements in the array. And of course we like to have a scope again to first split it and then used this array to perform our logic. So let's add a new width formula to do so. So let's call this this our columns or values or whatever, but let's call it columns and then say we want to split the lines we get from the for all function based on our comma. And then we get a false statement, but that's because this is not really determined as a string yet. Therefore, we need to return the results of the lines. Let's see where it goes, line result. There. So now it's a string, which we split based on the comma separation. And this will return an array to our basically scoped variable column. And then we can pick this column. And what we can do is return the first column dot result. Only now it's not a result anymore, but basically this is a dot value. And I think this should be this item, something like this. Okay, this doesn't work, so let's give this an alias of result. And then we can have the results dot value. So basically the formula didn't have a name for this, or wasn't able to say, okay, you mean this part of the formula, because I have two times the same thing like to return. That's why we give the width a alias, and then it's understand when I put results, I use this alias here. So now when we look at this, we have only our first rows returned to us, right? But that wasn't the goal. The goal was to return some HTML. So let's do a tr to start a new line, then the td to start the new line basically. So this is the body of the table, and then we have a first line. Then let's close this, do our data, and then afterwards close the line and close the tr body we have. And if we look then, we have basically HTML here. And maybe this is a good place to say, okay, let's save this formula and let's put it instead of this part, because we have HTML and HTML should be able to render. And here you see in the first column, we have our data. So I would say this works, right? So now this can go away and let's go further here. Now, first we want to have separate lines. So let's separate this part to an end here, put it on a different line, and the same for the closing text. You see, step by step, we're performing this. Now we have three values in here, and the first value, or we have four values, because we have the title, the date, so the second is the date, and let's make one formula who can we can use for everyone. So let's say the last of the first few items, and let's say we only want to have the first one item, and from this first one we want to have the last, which is of course the first. Logically, I hope you understand. So we need to have four columns, but the second should be the second item, the third item, and the fourth item. So this returns four items, so the fourth in this array, and from those four items returns the last, and then the results from there. So when I'm right, you see the first name, last name, and age. But of course, we don't need this here. And our header should change. So let's do that. So first, say, let's have modified here. Modified by. And the status we have. Then basically, we don't need this. But we need the second, the third, and the fourth. And this works, but now we have the date here in the UTC standard. So what we need to do is to have the date time value formula around our string, returning a real date, which is formatted in our Wuxin settings. And basically this is it. We are done. So we can have our lock. And for the latest thing, we can say, okay, this people shouldn't be able to watch. So we have our lock. We go back, we change our record, save this, go to our lock again, and see another line. If we go to another record, and we say this is a new record, then we go to inventory, we go to request PO, and if we are done, we have three changes here. And of course we can apply some extra design elements here, like padding or whatever we like, because we did it before and you now understand how to find it and how to use it. So I think this concludes this video. Now, I hope you like it, and if you do, like and subscribe, and thanks for watching, and I hope to see you in the next video. Right. See you later.